We'll start this afternoon's session with Solange Diaz. Dr. Diaz is from the Universidad Andrés Bello, Chile. Her topic today is Qhapaq Ñan in Chile, Management and Conservation of Atacama Desert Roads. For longer biographies, please consult your program guide. All the details in there. Thank you. Solange?
Hello, good afternoon. First of all, I'd like to thank Dr. Matos and the Department of State for the invitation to be here today with you. I want to tell you a little bit about something perhaps a little bit different than the others have talked about. My profile is a bit different. I'm not an archaeologist, I'm an architect. And for several years, about 9 years, I was in charge of the Qhapaq Ñan Initiative for World Heritage in Chile. So we're going to have a conversation that's a little bit different than what we have had so far in this symposium. Many of you have been present in the other conferences, and we have talked about what Qhapaq Ñan is. I know that many of you have defined it. Many of the great archaeologists here have defined what is Qhapaq Ñan, but in case we have any new people here right now, I can say that in Quechua it means the main road. And it's a term that's used to talk about this big road system that during the 15th and 16th century made possible the expansion of the Great Inka Empire, the Tawantinsuyu. They say that from north to south, it was a 6,000-mile extension, kilometers. It's about the distance from Washington, D.C. to the Bering Strait. That's approximately the north and south extension, but it was a great road system, and altogether it brought together about 33,000 kilometers of roads. As I was saying, there was an initiative from the Peruvian government between 1998-99 that invited six countries where the Inca Empire had some occupation to work on having this road or part of the road being recognized as a World Heritage Site. And that's how six countries together, Argentina, Bolivia, Colombia, Ecuador, Chile, and Peru, were able to work together for more than 13 years with the objective of identifying the best examples of this big Qhapaq Ñan that could be recognized by UNESCO and be included on the list of World Heritage Sites. It was a project with a very highly political connotation, and for that reason, there were presidents and foreign ministers that made statements over the years that supported this process of technical and political work to make sure that this road would be recognized internationally. There were also about 30 technical meetings in each of our countries, and there was a very firm support in the country of Peru from and politicians and technical experts began to reach agreements on how we were going to define certain things, what our criteria for selection was going to be, and how we were going to think about conserving this great cultural asset in the future. We had to talk a lot about integration and international consensus so that we could make progress on this project. Here, research and a lot of the people and the experts that have made presentations yesterday and today have been fundamental pillars in researching and investigating this Qhapaq Ñan. They had already been doing research on the road, but in the last decade, there was a renewed effort, and not only investigators from archaeology, but also environmental experts, geologists, historians, people who work on architecture. Victoria Castro was mentioning the component of oral history, because these communities are, these roads are connected to living communities, and also everything that was having to do with participation in dialogue with the communities who were living alongside this road. So in every country, we had to make a significant effort to begin research, a very strong effort. Chile perhaps was a country where that lagged behind a tiny bit in comparison to our other countries. We had to generate more research, therefore, to reach the standards that were being defined for each of the lines of research. Also, little by little, as the years went by, this group of countries, and the communities were already very clear about this, but the countries began to understand that this was a living asset, not just an archaeological artifact. That without the communities, the roads would not exist, of course, but especially because Qhapaq Ñan has material and immaterial attributes. The material attributes are the infrastructure of the road, all of the things that the other presentations have mentioned, the archaeological sites. There's the environment, the great landscape of the Andean world, and everything that has to do with the geomorphological and geological formations along the path. But Qhapaq Ñan is also associated with living communities, and therefore there is an intangible component that's very important, that's also part of what we are valuing and what we're trying to protect and conserve in order to transmit to future generations. All of these manifestations of our heritage can be expressed through oral history, languages, dress, knowledge about nature and the universe, traditional artisan techniques as well. So this is one of the most important statements in this research process, and is that Qhapaq Ñan belongs to a world view, a particular cosmovision and worldview of the Andean community. And so this great cultural initiative seeks not only to preserve the physical vestiges of the road, but also all of the manifestations of those things that are associated with this cultural asset. Little by little, and in this process, the countries have been defining the various categories in which this mega good fits. So Qhapaq Ñan is a great cultural itinerary on the one hand. It is a road through which all of these people shared visions and ideas and customs and language and handicrafts and trade. And through the Tawantinsuyu, they were able to be connected and to establish together a single worldview, single cosmovision. So around 2013, the countries presented to UNESCO the best examples of the Qhapaq Ñan that might be included on this list of the great World Heritage Sites. And so the six countries together formed a network. And we talk about World Heritage now, but it was 697 kilometers of road. Some 429 miles, if you understand miles better than kilometers. And there's a large number of acres of land that have been protected under this concept of World Heritage, but also 300 archaeological sites. And there's an important piece of information as well. More than 300 indigenous communities that are associated with this Qhapaq Ñan road and who belong to these great material attributes that the road has. And recently, in June of last year, it's been a year now since it has been declared a World Heritage Site. And this is not anything that is casual. It either for the communities, our authorities, or our states, because it means we have important responsibilities to protect and conserve these areas now. So we have great work ahead of us that has to do with reflecting and acting on how we're going to protect and to conserve all of these material attributes, both conserve and manage, as well as the non-material aspects. In the moment where each country and institutions like this one are collaborating to see how we can take steps on this together. I want to tell you a little bit about my country, Chile. So I want to tell you that in terms of selecting the stretches of the road that would be included in the list from Chile, we looked at the Atacama Desert. As many of you know, the Atacama Desert is the driest desert in the entire world. There are records that in 400 years there has not been any precipitation in certain during the history of humanity. And there's about 70,000 square miles. It's a very hostile and hospitable environment, but it's also a territory that has high mineral reserves, copper, gold, potassium, silver, lithium, all of these minerals that are found in great salt flats. And therefore, in the Chilean territory, what is currently Chile, the Incas were faced with a very great challenge in terms of how to deal with this very inhospitable environment. They had to know how to use the knowledge of the peoples who were already living in the areas, and that's how they were able to gain a dominion of this area, the most inhospitable area in this particular Suyu. These are some images of the landscapes in the Atacama Desert. And you can see the difficulty that this must have represented in large stretches of land where there's no water available. There's an important story associated with the roads in the Atacama Desert that is associated with mining, as I was mentioning earlier. And Christian Vitri explained very well that there is a worship of the high summits. And there is a story that's very important because there's salt flats and mining areas that have been used for many years, even before the arrival of the Incas. And so the road has, in the whole history of this using this 400 kilometers of road, there were some settlements where the Inca Empire exercised control. Now, the selection from Chile is located in the northern area of the country, and it covers about 590 miles, more or less. And there were small portions that were selected that were in the best states of conservation and that were the most relevant that were selected in that space. But the Incas had an important presence all the way down to the central part of Chile. And they had presence from the very northern area down to about 1,000 miles south. Today, we have turned the map around, so you can see it horizontally. And as we were talking with the communities, and the researchers were talking with the communities, these routes that were declared World Heritage Sites were assigned names and concepts that were closer to the oral histories that the communities had about the roads. And so, for example, in the northernmost extreme, you have the route of the mountains, the copper route associated with the copper deposits that are very important in Chile. Then there's the Inca route. And there's also the Ruta del Despoblado, the route of the unpopulated area. And there's the Andean Capricornian route as well. These are more images that Victoria and Mauricio, great Chilean archaeologists, talked about in great detail this morning. Now, I'm not the best expert in archaeology, but I can say that each one of the pieces of the route that were selected has to do with the greatest contribution that my country could make to this Qhapaq Ñan project. We have some roads that have been paved with stone, and this is related to the fact that the great copper mines are located in the area. And they were people that were there even before the Incas that were mining copper there. And there's Tukikamana mine that is the largest mine there, and other mines as well. This is the Topa Inca route, where we have the largest archaeological site that has the largest number of artifacts. And it has about 800 spaces. And as part of the research, we were able to get topographic and architectonic maps. Water management was done through channels that were running alongside the roads. Here we have got the plateau of Matarte that was spoken about this morning as well. And the Andean Capricornian route goes through the most inhospitable area of the Atacama Desert and the most unpopulated area. And little by little, the road becomes harder and harder, and it becomes a greater and greater feat to be able to go through this area. Here we have finally the most difficult part of the route. The route becomes narrower and narrower, and it's still a formalized road. So the challenge is great to see how we are going to protect and conserve all of these attributes of the Qhapaq Ñan. And we want to show you how the various countries, because this isn't my information, this is information that belongs to the six countries. We've been generating studies to try to understand the typologies in each country and to see where we might have similar kinds of roads and places. In the case of Chile, little by little, we began to realize that we had some different typologies, some variations in roads and archaeological sites. There were places where there were prior settlements of populations before the Incas, and you could see how the Incas came in and displaced some of these areas that were sacred areas for other peoples. For example, in the place of Turi, there was a cayanca that was built, which was the administrator's house, the Inca administrator's house. And we also realized that our roads are similar to some and different from others. And the Incas had difficulties going through this area to conquer the region. There is a typology where there is less investment in construction, where there's less infrastructure. So when we think about the typologies, at least in the Chilean case, we're saying, how are we going to deal with conservation? Obviously,